Good morning. Can I have your attention, please? Happy Good Friday for you. Last Friday that we'll see you here, I guess, for the month. Yeah, but you're not nearly as happy as I am. We have a guest speaker with us today, and when we decided he was coming, I thought, well, how am I going to introduce this guy? This is Wes Knight. He's my oldest son. And I'm thinking, okay, you know, what do I want to relay to you about Wes? So I thought, well, you know, I'll just stand up here and say, here's my son, Wes Knight, from Charlotte, North Carolina. And we give him a little round of applause, and everything goes okay. But Charlotte is where he is living presently. His travels have taken him in other places. So I could say Wes Knight from Raleigh, North Carolina. Big round of applause. Well, now, we don't really need the applause every time, but you get the point, okay? So we go to San Antonio. Wes Knight from San Antonio, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Now let me introduce Wes Knight from Edmonton, Canada. Well, okay. Coming to you from South Africa, Wes Knight. Welcome to the States, Wes Knight from Vancouver, British Columbia. Our own Wes Knight from Charleston, South Carolina. But you know what? In reality, I have to introduce Wes Knight from your seat right now. What, 15 years ago? He was sitting where you are sitting now. He is a product of Palmetto Middle School. So please help me welcome my son, who I'm very proud of, to speak with you today on perseverance, Wes Knight.
How about Mr. Knight, huh? He's the man, isn't he? Raise your hand if you like Mr. Knight. Raise two hands if you like me and he's annoying. Hey, not all the same, my dad is my Barry Knight, Mr. Knight, you know him, incredible guy, even better father, okay? Great leader. But I got a great story about that man that just introduced me, all right? So I'm the eldest, just like he said. I've got a younger brother. He's five and a half years younger than me. Good guy, but I'm the troublemaker, all right? I'm always getting into something, stirring up stuff. I'm ADD, so I'm here, I'm there, I'm everywhere, getting involved, right? My brother, he's more cerebral, right? He uses his mind, he's smarter. We'll just call it that, okay? But what I used to be able to do is kind of motivate my brother to get in some of the trouble with me, okay? So one day, I was probably 12 years old, do the math, seven my brother probably was, seven, 8 years old, somewhere around there. Okay, we were up to something. Who remembers the laser pointers that used to have? You guys remember the laser pointers? So we had a laser pointer and a cat that loved laser pointers. You see where I'm going with this story. All right, so my dad is a snorer. And man, does this guy rumble when he snores, man. You can hear dad snoring miles down the road, okay? So dad's at it. It's probably 6:30 at night. He's snoring his butt off, okay? Literally. My brother and I, playing with the cat and the laser pointer, we go in and check it out, all right? Dad is laying in the bed with his leg pulled over the cover and his bottom hanging out, snoring his face off. So I look at my brother and I'm like, you thinking what I'm thinking, dude? He's like, yep. But I'm like, you do it. He's like, no, you. No, you do it. Okay, so my brother takes it. What do you think happens? Takes the laser pointer, points it on my dad's butt, and guess what happens? The cat jumps from the ground, scratches the crap out of my pops. I've never heard this guy jump up and scream like he screamed. straight out of Snore. Okay, so that guy in the back of the room that just introduced me, at one point, he was an award-winning bodybuilder, a Division I college football player, a man of men, you know what I mean? But every time now, he tries to be tough guy. I'm like, Dad, you remember when we made you scream like a little child, right? So anytime you see him and he's trying to be tough guy, remind him of the cat and the laser pointer. Anyways, look, I appreciate you've welcomed me today, okay? The one thing that is very important in my life, in my story, is perseverance. And I was really excited when my dad gave me the opportunity to come and share a little bit of my story, okay? But it's not all about me. Stories of perseverance exist all over the place, all right? And they are inspiring. Everyone loves a hero's story, all right? Someone who's come from the seats that you're sitting in, who has had the teachers that you've had, who's walked the halls and listened to the bells and done all of the things that you've done to go on and do things that they wanted to do. Not just sports, artists. Mr. Addison, look at the incredible things that he creates, all right? Math teachers who give you knowledge, implant information into your mind that will never leave. People are doing incredible things all over the place, right? It is not just pro athletes. It is not just actors and entertainers. People are doing things of incredible importance all over the place. And I'm going to highlight just a couple before we get into my story. Okay, perseverance. On the far left, right, is a man who is very esteemed, but I bet few of you recognize him. Does anyone on the far left recognize who that is? Anyone? You can raise your hand. Don't be shy. Any guesses? Go ahead. Stand up so I can hear you.
Does he have something to do with Starbucks?
Oh, that's my man. Give me some love, dude. That was incredible. That was incredible. Well done, buddy. Okay. Listen up. That's Howard Schultz. Howard Schultz is the creator and founder of Starbucks. Let me tell you a little bit about his story. We all know Starbucks. All of us love enjoying a good drink. I know I do. A double iced espresso with coconut milk is my jam. You know what I mean? I drink that every day. Gives me a little boost. But let me tell you how that idea got into a cup in my hand. All right? Howard Schultz. He's in Seattle, Washington. Beautiful place. It's about 2 hours underneath Vancouver where I started my professional career. Okay? Howard Schultz has a great product. A bean company, right? At that time called Starbucks. No one knows what Starbucks is. Okay, he's got an incredible product, but he's got no way to get it to in the hands of everyone he wants to taste it. Family, friends, and extended members of his area of influence are the only people that can taste his product. So he's thinking, man, how do I take this idea for my coffee in my mind and create it? Literally create it. So he's thinking, what do you need to start a business? First and foremost, money. Money is very important. Capital is another name for it. So you need a capital. Who has all the money? Investors, but where's the money stored? Banks. Very good, very smart group. Okay? So he's got to go to banks to ask for money. It's called a loan. He's got to get loaned the money to be able to start a shop that will be his first shop that he can serve what? That's the road, right? That's his vision. I want to be able to start a shop that's going to get my product out. Okay, he goes to the first bank. No, thank you. I don't want to invest. We don't think that your idea is good enough. 15 banks later, same thing. So he reworks his direction and his idea. He says, okay, instead of going to banks, maybe I can go try to talk to millionaires and billionaires and see if they will angel invest. An angel investor is someone who has money and they'll give it to someone else outside of a bank. So they become their own bank, essentially. Okay? So he's going for these private investors and he's saying, hey, this is my idea. Come taste my coffee, man. It is good. Okay? And they like it, but they're like, hey, you know, I don't really want to give you my money because I don't believe in the idea that you believe in. Okay? 248 banks and investors total told him no. Let me put that in perspective for you, okay? That is, who has math? We all have math, yeah? Some of us like math, some of us are good at math. I'm not. I'm not a numbers guy, all right? I know what I am and I know what I'm not. Not a numbers guy, okay? That would be me or you failing 248 math tests over and over and over, Okay, that would be almost a year of every day taking the exact same math test, just to put that in perspective. 249th bank says, Howard, here goes your money. Continue with your dream. What did he do? He took Starbucks and turned it into the most recognizable name for coffee in the world. 248 people told him he can't do it, but he persevered. Okay, second guy in the middle. Who's that? Steph Curry. We all know that guy. He's sick, isn't he? His game is so nice, right? Steph Curry is my stature. All right, I'm almost 6 feet tall. He's probably 2 to 3 inches taller than me. We're about the same size in bulk, okay? So looking at me is kind of like looking at Steph Curry when you think of the stature. This guy plays in the NBA, a league full of 6'4" and taller players, okay? But he is about to become a two-time NBA MVP. But it wasn't always easy for Steph. Let me tell you why. Steph Curry is a native of Charlotte, North Carolina, where I live, okay? Even more closely, he went to a school called Davidson University, which is right in my backyard where I live, literally 3 miles away from me. And it is probably the size of Williamston. It's a very quaint, very small area, okay? Not much going on, so you would think, all right? But here's Steph's story. There are over 250 Division I NCAA basketball programs that exist, okay? Only one would give Steph Curry a basketball scholarship. One. Okay? What that did for Steph Curry, what do you think that did for him? If somebody tells you you're not good enough, what would it make you? You would say you don't care? Would you get angry and want to prove them wrong? Yes. She says a little bit. I think a lot bit as well. Okay? Steph Curry said, listen, you're going to tell me I'm not good enough? You're going to tell me that North Carolina, NC State, all of these teams that are supposed to be the powerhouses of basketball are going to pass up on me and I'm going to have to go to this little school called Davidson, right? He motivated him. Every day, day in and day out, he worked. And now he has turned himself in to a two-time NBA MVP. Perseverance. Never giving up, all right? Never stopping. Last one. For all the females in the room, anyone recognize that person, that lady? Who's that? J.K. Rowling. J.K. Rowling, nailed it. Air fist bump right there, atta girl. Well done, J.K. Rowling. Who's that, some of you may say, all right? I know my little brother knows Harry Potter better than anyone in this room, probably. He is a wizard when it comes to knowledge, right? J.K. Rowling, she was homeless when she was writing the Harry Potter series. She was homeless. She was living in her car with a daughter, providing for two mouths, hers and her daughter's, and trying to write this dream, this vision, this idea she had in her head, which was the Harry Potter story. 11 publishing accounts turned her down. They said, we don't like your story, until the 12th gave it to the head of the publisher, gave the story to his child. The child read it and wanted more. Dad, I want to finish this story. What's going to happen? So the 12th publishing company gave her the deal, which turned into Harry Potter, the most recognizable book series and arguably one of the most recognizable movie series in history, right? And she was homeless, okay? Nowhere to live. Awesome stories of perseverance. Let me tell you a little bit about my story. My story was always about a vision, right? Not too long ago, I was sitting in this exact seat as you were, probably 15, 20 years ago. This seat, all right? Watching people talk about things that they did, all right? I want to be a doctor. I want to be an engineer. You know, I'm an orthopedic surgeon. I do surgery on athletes' knees. You know, and they'd come and talk. And I'd be thinking, man, I don't want to be a doctor. I'm not going to fix people. But I am going to be a soccer player. I can see it. I can see it clear as day. I can see myself playing in the stadiums. I can see myself giving high fives to the fans. I can see myself scoring a goal and running to the corner flag. But that was my vision. That was my vision. That's what I wanted. And let me tell you this. There were individuals, and there will always be individuals, who will listen to your story when you tell them, and they will laugh. And they will say, man, are you kidding me? You're from Williamston, South Carolina. Dude, playing the MLS? You're joking, right? That's hilarious. Everyone here plays baseball, football, basketball. No one plays soccer. 15, 20 years ago, there was no JV or varsity soccer team that you could have access to in middle school. That didn't exist for me, right? So I had to learn how to go out and find where the soccer players were playing. Because in my mind, I had a vision, right? I had direction. And I knew where I was going, even if no one else knew it. Okay, vision is very important. When you think about who your best version of yourself is, that is your vision. It doesn't matter what that is, right? My dad is a principal, right? And he's a cool dude, but he doesn't have tattoos, okay? He sure doesn't have tattoos. He sure doesn't gel his hair to the side and wear gold necklaces, does he? But we're different, but we're of the same blood, and it's okay. Whatever your vision is your vision, and that's important that it's yours. And you need to decide what it is, and you need to grab it, and you need to run with it. Protect it, because there will be people who will sour your time, all right? So vision, soccer player, okay? Middle school, not many outlets, but I'm on a traveling team, and I'm working hard trying to see my goal, okay? To be a pro, all right? Working hard. In that time, I start to grow older. Colleges start to come knocking. Well, it's Division II schools, Division III schools. No big schools are really coming for me. Okay, little kid from Williamston, South Carolina. These college coaches are thinking, small town kid, man, he can't play. So I didn't get offered. I signed with the College of Charleston for a recruited walk-on spot. They said, we'll give you a spot on the team, but we'll not give you any money. They basically said, you're good enough to hold a jersey. Man, first two or three days, I was mad. I was embarrassed. I didn't even want to tell my friends. If you ask my friends now, very few know that. I kept it hidden because I was embarrassed. All my other buddies from my team are getting college scholarships, and I'm not. What do you mean? Adversity, knocked down for the first time, okay? So I went into school, and I was motivated by that. You know what, coach? I'm going to show you I deserve a full scholarship. I'm going to show you that I'm going to be a pro. Watch me. Watch me. Okay? And minute by minute, day by day, hour by hour, I put in work. But let me tell you a little thing about decisions. All right? Decisions are important in life because we as human beings have an innate ability to think that we're going to fail before we convince ourselves that we're going to succeed. All right? Let me say that one more time because that's very important. We have an innate ability to believe we're gonna fail before we believe we're gonna succeed. Now, think of how twisted that is. If you are living in your body and you are the creator of your own thoughts, then why would you believe that you're gonna fail before you believe that you're gonna succeed? So, success, it's a learned skill. It's learned, okay? You have to over and over believe that when your mind is telling you to be lazy or not go to class or not do homework, you have to quickly convince yourself otherwise, okay? So for me, that muscle in my mind, I had to, every time I switched myself from thinking negatively to positively, it was a bicep curl for my brain. Does that make sense, right? It was a bicep curl. My brain was getting stronger. My brain was growing. My belief in myself, that was growing. And I worked, and I worked, and I worked until 2009, I was signed by the Vancouver Whitecaps. I had a 7-year career in the span of that time that took me all over the earth. I've been in Africa, okay? I've been in safaris and seen real lions, all right? And this is the same guy that's sitting in these seats you've sat in, right? I've been to Vancouver, lived in a different country. I've been to south of the border to Mexico and spoke a little Spanish. All right, I've had great opportunities, but soccer was my vehicle, it was my vision. All right, take a little look at what my career spanned to. Thank you.
I had a way then, losing it all on my own. I had a heart then, but the queen has been overthrown. And I'm not sleeping now, the dark is too hard to beat. And I'm not keeping now, the strength I need to push me. You show the lights that stole me, turn to a storm, shining.
Not bad. Okay? That is years and years and years of making you feel, other people making you feel like your dream is not good enough, not being able to believe in yourself, and me focusing on what I wanted, the path, the journey that I knew I had that's in my mind. You have to protect that. Now, so that looks cool, right? Playing on ESPN, you know, meeting David Beckham, playing against David Beckham, Thierry Henry, some of the idols that I watched when I was young now became my rivals. That seems like a good life, right? Well, I also had a good-looking girlfriend. And I thought I had a cool car. Man, life for me was good, man. It was good. I had no complaints. But what happens when you get there?
One more?
But what normally happens when you're on a pedestal? Yeah, you get knocked down. So let me tell you about what I like to call when life knocked the life out of me, okay? 2014, I'm in Edmonton, Alberta, okay? It's a neighboring province of Alberta to British Columbia. It's above Montana over in the western part of the US, or Canada, of the continent, okay? So I'm there, I'm playing, my girlfriend has just moved in with me, think I'm probably gonna marry this girl. Man, life is good, right? Everything's going great. All of a sudden, I blow my knee out in a game, okay? When I say I blow my knee out, I had two injuries, one ACL injury, the other microfracture technique. The microfracture technique has been proven a career ender for most athletes. So I had to hear the doctor look at me in my face after surgery, and he said, look, the condition of your knee is in really bad shape. If you continue to play, you're probably not gonna be mobile when you get older, all right? So basically what he said is, Wes, I'm taking your dream away. I'm taking you and the person that you are, the soccer player, that I'm wiping that out. I'm taking the dry erase eraser and I'm wiping that off. For me, that was paralyzing. I could not figure out how and why this could happen to me. I had it all. What do you mean? I had it all. But let me tell you a little bit about when life knocks the life out of you. That's when life pushes you. It shows you adversity, and it stretches you, and it challenges you to a point where you do not feel comfortable, and that's where you grow. And those are those moments where you expand, and you gain experience, and you become stronger. But it has to start with a choice. Starts with a choice, okay? As I was being expanded, as I was growing, I was fortunate enough for me to be able to have a film crew that came and they documented a little bit about my journey, okay? So I got a small clip that showed you a little bit of the rehab process to try to rebuild that part of my life, all right? Rebuild that part of my life because my job was my career. My career made me money. My money put food on the table, and food on the table did what for me? Keeps me what? Someone said it. Kept you alive, my man. Answer, great answer. All right? Kept me alive. I needed my job. That's me. That's who I am. It makes me money, right? Right? We'll take a watch.
Mike stays down, and West Knight is in on Fry. Knight squares it for Hurstler.
The untold story of sport is simple for me because I'm living in it.
Feet can keep on the ground. Can't stay in one place.
There is the aspect of being the pro and doing what you love every day, and that's the high. And then there's this injury, which compounds a very low with the valley of it, the valley and the dumpster and the pits and the shitstorm of professional sports, where you're relying on your body to make you. It is your identity. And when everything you know of you is wrapped in that identity, when that is gone, then what? Back in 2008, before I became a professional, I partially tore my ACL in a game in Florida. And in that tackle, that initial tackle, I felt something in my knee, but didn't know what it was, just kind of a tingling feeling. I kept playing, but I always knew something had happened, something was different. So law of attraction comes in. I'm starting to think about the surgery and maybe in some sorts wishing it. And then flash forward to that instant in Edmonton against Carolina when my knee finally went in my heart. I knew this was the beginning of a long, long road. And ever since then, it has been just that, just a journey, such an intense journey for me. I'm living in this zone of where no one sees what you're doing on a daily basis to recover. Teams are signing guys up, and you, the injured player, are here in your little bubble, away from everyone and everything that you're used to, the comfort of team and camaraderie and family in a sense, and it's just you. And every day, it's up to you to get up, get to the gym, and give an honest effort. Even when you don't know if you're ever gonna play again, there is no guarantee in professional sports. If this is the end, what now? So everything for me is kind of riding on that. And the mental aspect, and the mental toll, and the mental battle, in a lot of ways it feels like your world is kind of folding in on you. Randy Celebrini and his brother Rick have developed an unbelievable methodology, and they are totally committed to making their athletes better than they were pre-injury. And he believes in me now and wants me to succeed and wants us to succeed, because now his name is behind my rehab. Nick Held is probably the most experienced hydrotherapist in Canada, and I'm fortunate enough to work with him at Fortius, and he can look at a movement immediately in the feedback and break it down for me and get me to change it. And so literally Fortius and Nick are redefining the way I move. And so it's honestly, it's a new step for me. It's almost gonna be a brand new West Knight when it's finished. Kevin Harms and I have a similar road in the sense of injuries, and we're kind of in a point now where we're looking for clubs and trying to get ourselves back on track in our careers. And the long-standing friendship that we've had dates back before the injury. I mean, even as simple as going out and having some pints together and just laughing and kicking the shit. And just those things are invaluable. Most all of the athletes that are in Fortius there, including Kevin, are at a point where they can do all dynamic movements. And for me, I can't yet. I haven't gotten clearance. And so every time I see Kevin with a ball, it's tough. Part of me said, all right, I always wanted my knee to be fixed. Now it's real. My ACL is fixed. It's fixed by a world-renowned doctor. I couldn't have been taken care of any better What's real now is I've got a support system and everyone's trying to help me succeed. And we just have to make it happen. It just has, it has to happen. There's no other way.
Okay, so let me tell you a little bit of what that journey taught me, okay? That journey of being kicked and having the life knocked out of me, life knocked the life out of me, taught me five important pieces to perseverance, right? Here they are. Number one is the most important for me, and that's emotion, okay? Emotion for me, it created motion, right? When I was angry, I started moving. When I was sad, I had to get up and start going, right? When I was embarrassed, whatever emotion I felt, I used it, I made the decision to use it as fuel because emotion creates motion, right? It is okay, fellas, to cry. Believe me, you. I've shed my fair share of tears, right? Things are not always gonna go like you want it. But when you do cry, how quickly can you figure out how to use and bottle those tears into something that's gonna positively propel you forward? Emotion creates motion. Number two, commitment. Okay, what is commitment? Someone raise their hand and tell me what commitment is. What's commitment? Stand up for me, please, so I can hear you. Ah, I love that. How much will you sacrifice, right? How hard are you willing to continue going despite what happens? Okay, so commitment for me was, hey, maybe I don't need to go and party with my buddies that are going to party because I need to be in the gym, working hard, doing the things I need to do to get back to doing what? Playing soccer. So for you, okay, maybe you want to go to college. Whatever, what's your vision? Maybe you don't want to go to college. Maybe you want to create a brand new version of the iPad. There are someone in here that I bet will have an opportunity to do that. Maybe you want to get into the digital age and you want to create a new Pixar, all right? How cool is that? Whatever your vision is, here's the key. Listen carefully. Are you committed to that vision and that version of yourself that you see in your mind, okay? Make decisions with commitment that are being made for that person, not for who you are today, all right? That person, 20 years later, if I make this decision, will that take me off course of being that best version of myself? That's real commitment, okay? Number three, ambition. Now, ambition is a doozy of a word, right? Because it can go in many different directions. Somebody tell me what ambition is to them. Come on, show me some love. Someone raise your hand. In the back, stand up so I can hear you, please, if you don't mind. She killed it. Well done. Well done. She killed it. Determined to do something that you love, okay? Ambition is the driver. If emotion is the fuel, ambition is the driver. It's going to get you to your destination, okay? So energy, that's the unleaded fuel. Ambition is the what? The driver, okay? That's gonna steer you in the right direction, gonna get you out of bed every day and push you to do the things that you should do, to do the extra reading for your classes, for your tests, to go a little bit further and maybe do extra math problems, okay? Because you know you wanna kill that test. That's ambition, right? Four, relationships are so important. And I'm not talking about your girlfriend, the ones that leave you when you're injured. I'm talking about relationships that really matter. What really makes me understand this situation, relationships. Imagine everyone that you know has an oxygen tank on their back, okay? Oxygen tank, all right? Your good friends have oxygen tanks with an oxygen mask, all right? And when life knocks the life out of you and you have times of adversity, your friends are gonna be the ones that hook up their oxygen tank to you and give you life. Good friends have 100% oxygen, full of positivity, makes you feel great, can promote you to do things that you didn't believe you could do sometimes. That's good friends. Raise your hand if you got a good friend like that. We all have at least one. Could be a family member, could be a distant cousin, could be a friend, could go to our school, doesn't matter. Now, obviously there's two types, right? Relationships also have the other side. There's those people with the same oxygen tank, but inside it's full of cigar-filled or cigarette-filled tar smoke. That when you hook up your oxygen tank to that person, what do you feel? Feel bad. You feel negative. Maybe they pick on you. Maybe they make you feel less of what you really are. Okay? Those are the weak people. Those are the ones that are not happy in themselves. And it's just like a chair that's sitting that looks like it's not stable. Would you sit in that? If I looked like this one was shaking and I wanted to go sit down in front of this class, I'd look like a fool if I sat in that chair, wouldn't it? Because it would do what? It would crumble. You understand what I'm saying? So, don't lean on weak people. Find the strong, positive people in your life and lean on them. Use their oxygen for all it's worth, because there's going to be another time where they're going to be out of oxygen, and what do you think you're going to need to do? Yeah, you're going to take that mask and you're going to put it on them. Okay, relationships, very valuable to perseverance. Last, belief. What's your belief system? Do you believe in something bigger than yourself? All right? Whatever that is, could be God, it could be Allah, it could be Buddha. You could even believe in nothing. Whatever you believe in, though, go above and beyond yourself for that purpose. Okay, so if you're a believer in God, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, right? Everything that you do, you give the glory to Him. If you're Buddha, I do good things because what's going to happen in return? Good things will come back. It's called karma, all right? Those things are very important. If you don't believe in anything, which is totally okay, whatever your belief system is, your belief system, okay? If you believe in nothing, I strongly recommend that you turn your belief system to those relationships that are important, those strong relationships, those 100% oxygen bearers, okay? Because when you go and do something for someone else, it in turn makes you feel better. Okay? So, emotion, commitment, ambition, relationships, and belief. These five things, when you're going through your journey in life, will help pick you up off the ground when you're down and push you back in motion moving forward. You guys have fun?
Yeah.
Awesome. I've got time for three questions, and we're going to play a game for it. All right? So everyone stand up. You got to earn... First thing is first. First things first. Most important thing is to remain respectful to me, please. Respectful to me to me would be not chatting, all right? And playing the game the right way. Here's the game. Those of you standing on the word go, the slowest to sit down has to ask me a question. And your question can be whatever you like it to be, all right? So, what's the operative word here? Go. So you're listening for... Almost. So you're listening for go, okay? Last one down. I will see. We'll have to ask me a question. That'll be the first one. So, ready? Set. Oh. Go. Troublemaker. There's two right there. All right, we'll have these two males ask, and then I'd like to get a question from some of the beautiful women that I see out here. And Palmetto has great, great talent in here. It wasn't like that when I went, by the way. Well done. Okay. We'll start with Mr. Palmetto Baseball on the left, man. What's your name, first of all? Easton. Is that after the baseball bat? Could be. Anyways, hey, Mr. Florida Gator, will you have a seat? So I'll pull in you next. Thanks, dude. Hit me with your question. Ah, great question. I played many sports. I ran track when I was younger. I played t-ball until I realized that I kept hitting the tee further than the ball. So I gave that up. Played a little basketball. And then I played football. I actually played at Wren and beat Palmetto. But, I'm kidding. I played basketball, JV basketball, and then I played C-team football. But by ninth grade, I knew soccer was my thing. All right? Soccer was my thing. What about you, Mr. Gator? Yeah, man. Come on.
All right.
I like
it's
it.
Sound silly, but this is legit.
Okay.
Who is your barber?
Who is my barber, he asked? Great question. Supercuts. Supercuts is my, I can't propel myself to pay any more than $12, $15 for a haircut. So Supercuts is my deal. All right, hey, great questions. Anyone else who's curious about anything in life? Young lady, have a, stand up so I can see you.
Do you play now?
Do I play now? That's a great question. I am retired now. As of August 1st, 2000 and what was last year, 15? I retired and I began a coaching career. My new vision for myself is to do exactly what I'm doing today. Okay, and what I'm doing right now is I'm teaching. All right? I'm teaching people how to become the better versions of themselves. All right? This is my new goal. This is my new ambition. This is my new drive. And this is the direction that I'm headed now. All right? So, do I play anymore? No. And I was an athlete. But you can no longer call me Wes Knight the athlete alone. All right? Now I'm at Wes Knight the teacher, Wes Knight the speaker, Wes Knight the artist. I have very, very many outlets now that help me when other things leave, all right? So putting your identity on just one thing is very dangerous. Having multiple outlets is very, very good, okay? I saw another hand, another girl that had a question. Is that you? No? Nothing? Have it, stand up, don't be shy.
Okay, so like, I'm not interested in playing sports, but
cool.
Oh
man, give me a hug, first of all. Give me a hug. I believe you can do what you can, whatever it is you want to do, first of all. Now, she's. Let me tell you what is interesting about, what's your name?
Kylie.
Let me tell you what's interesting about Kylie. She is the strongest individual in this auditorium. Let me tell you why. She just stood up and professed her fear to everyone. That's strength. That's power. Strength and power is not a guy who can jump the highest and run the fastest, and answer the questions in math the quickest. Strength is the individual who can say, hey, I'm struggling with something right now, and no one believes in me because I don't fit the mold of what anyone else believes you should look like. That's strength. That's incredible, okay? So what do I tell somebody who feels like they have no support? Let me tell you this. You have more support than you realize, right? And how does she have support? She's got support in good relationships, supplying 100% oxygen. She's got a good relationship with herself, obviously, because she has the courage to stand up and say what no one else would say in this auditorium, right? She's fearless. She's gonna be successful. She's got courage, all right? Holding things in, holding your desires and your fears and things that are scary for you, that is counterproductive. When you have fear and you have doubt and you don't think you can go anymore, what do you rely on? What do you rely on? Get back to the things that make you happy and focus back on the relationships that you have with yourself and with the people around you that can push you to be the best version of yourself. Well done. That's fantastic. That's the best thing to have. Excellent. Anyone else? One more. I got time for one more. Stand up, big guy.
Did your family help you at all? Like, when you were struggling?
Okay.
Hi. Talk about your friend.
Yeah. What's your name, pal? Great questions, guys. These are fantastic. What's your name?
James.
James. James asked, did your family help you when you were down? Because you only talked about friends. When I became a pro athlete, I got so far away from my reality. I thought that I was the man, and I didn't need my family. They didn't understand me. You know, they don't know who I am. I'm up here doing things. They don't know what I'm doing. So there was a time in my life where I turned my back on my family, and I would chat with them every now and then, but I didn't really understand what family really meant until I got knocked off my pedestal. And guess who was there to catch me? Mom, Dad, my brother were there with open arms. Listen, buddy, I know you're in a hard time. I know you've made some bad decisions. But hey, dude, we still love you, man. We still love you, okay? Those things are vitally important. They took all three of their oxygen masks and put it right on my face. I had no choice but to stand up on my feet and go again. Okay? So family is important. Love your family. They are your blood. And they will be with you through good times and bad. Okay? Guys, I've had a great time. I've had an unbelievable time. I appreciate you welcoming me back to Palmetto. And I hope you guys have an awesome spring break. Okay? Awesome. Last thing I did forget. I've got three tickets that I'm going to choose here to give away for free dance passes for tonight. All right? So if I call your name, come up and get your tickets. Okay? All right, first one. If I slaughter your name, I do apologize in advance. All right? Katrina Mouse? Is it Mouse? Is that right? Wow, I got it right. First try. Awesome. Congratulations. Second one. This one's easier. Jordan Thompson? Jordan Thompson. Congratulations, man. I'm a Michael Jordan fan, too. Give me some love. Yeah. Okay. Oh, Jordan Thompson, you won twice, big dog. What is that? How has that happened? Gracie Burton. Come on up, Gracie. Are you an athlete? You look like an athlete. What do you play?
Volleyball.
What don't you play is the question, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Congratulations. Now, last thing. We have one teacher that's winning $20 by whatever, whomever I pull out, this teacher wins $20. I'm just giving away free money. I don't think there's a teacher on there. Mr. Adams. Okay, last thing is, thank you. Congratulations, $20. $20 richer. The JV. The JV, and if we have any varsity JV or varsity soccer players, boys and girls, please meet me at the front here. Everyone else, you're dismissed to head to your next.